Blade Latimore is thankful that 5 days ago he was given a mobile for his 16th birthday. Late yesterday, he decided to walk home from school after discovering he didn't have his bus pass.
I somehow wandered off the track into some scrubland near a swamp and I had no idea where I was.
Cold and with light fading fast, Blade was hopelessly lost for 2 hours in the Redhead Swamp. He then phoned police.
Because of the time and the darkness that was coming upon us, I thought it'd be quicker if we could get the initial search done by Westpac. We would have been 2.5 to 3 hours to get to him.
The Westpac chopper flew to the swamp, guided all the while by Blade on his mobile.
He told us which way he was in relation to the spotlight on the aircraft, and when we ascertained where he was, it was just a matter of us throwing a high-intensity strobe light down to him to relocate him again in case we did lose him. He stayed on the telephone the whole time during the rescue, and we were able to winch him out.
Blade was unharmed throughout the ordeal. The Year 10 Belmont Baptist School student is counting his blessings he was carrying his mobile.
I'm very, very glad of the help that Westpac and the police did for me.
Well, I'd say it could have possibly saved his life. It definitely got him out of there quicker.
Blake Doyle, NBN News.
Billed as the centrepiece of the federal budget last night, $1.8 million for regional Australia. But there was little cause for celebration around the Hunter. Business leaders claimed major infrastructure projects from medical research to defence were completely overlooked.
Well, I thought the Hunter would have fared a lot better than what we did. They were talking about regionalisation issues, so I thought that there would have been something coming to regional infrastructure which would have been good for us to work on in this area.
One project that didn't rate a mention was Williamtown RAF Base's Airborne Early Warning and Control Defence Program. The $2 billion project is scheduled to form an integral part of the Eastern Command Centre.
There is no indication in this budget that that has changed. Indeed, on top of that, we've spent $2.8 million extra at Williamtown.
A healthier response from local GPs, though, who say any money towards rural health is a bonus. Newcastle University will also benefit with more places on offer for doctors in training at the local medical school. But unfortunately, there was little left over for anything else.
There is steady as she goes in terms of the allocations to the Australian higher education sector, but at least we don't have any further funding cuts.
And welfare groups say once again the budget does little to bridge the gap between welfare and finding work. Today's winter appeal dominated by the crucial issue.
And that has major implications for Samaritans because we're the final safety net, and if people come to us because they've lost their income, that's going to put a lot of pressure on us.
Helen Kapalos, NBN News.
St Francis Xavier hit hard early, but the boys in blue from Singleton got back up. They were full of running and looked like getting around the Hamilton High School's heavy defence. But it was St Francis Xavier fullback Michael Pontazis who scored first. A minute later, Joel Rawlins crossed for the first of his double. Mistakes became the order of Singleton's day. They only completed 2 sets of 6 in the first half, hardly the answer to the classy play of the flick-passing Australian schoolboy lock, Anthony Quinn. He scored a try of his own soon after when Singleton's fullback slipped. Just minutes later, Quinn added another. St Francis Xavier came out from the break leading 24-0 and continued to pile on the points. Cheeky play from the red-headed centre Rowan Kelly ended in a very sharp try to Alex Peterson. So dominant was Francis Xavier that Anthony Quinn even gave Singleton a lift. But that did more harm than good. The boys from Hamilton won 44-0 and will play the best team from the Western Division next week.
It's obvious that taxation office workers at Newcastle were less than pleased with their employer today, showing their anger over a pay offer during a nationwide stop work meeting. These workers are responsible for dealing with Australia's biggest ever tax reform when the GST is implemented in July. But they say if their current workload is anything to go by, the nation is less than prepared, and they're not willing to accept the Commissioner's pay offer of 4 plus 4% over 2 years, with a 2% lump sum to cover extra work for tax reform.
And we're saying that's just not enough. He received 24% in his last pay agreement, and we believe that we should be receiving something which is a little bit closer to the market.
Workers are now pushing for that mark to be a 6% rise, with a further 6% to be implemented over 2 years. And they claim until that's the case, work bans will apply, delaying a backlog of claims.
From tomorrow onwards, we'll be looking at targeting areas such as the processing of Australian business numbers.
Further negotiations are expected to take place over the dispute in the coming week. Helen Kapalos, NBN News.
It's a rare sight. Not only are the vintage motorcycles themselves hard to come by, but the chances of seeing so many in the same place is nearly just as rare. It's taken 2 years of planning, but now more than 200 enthusiasts from all over Australia, as well as some entries from New Zealand and the United Kingdom, are riding in Rally 2000. All motorcycles were made between 1910 and 1950. The bikes are hard to start and stop, so riders have given the big cities a miss and leave Walker Waterworks near Maitland each day for a ride through the country. It's all a lead-up to a display including all the vintage motorcycles to be held on Saturday at the Waterworks. Brooke Webster, NBN News.
They're two of society's more stereotyped groups, Aboriginal youths and police. Often at odds, they came together in Newcastle today for a tour of police facilities. It's all part of an education, training and youth affairs program to look at career options.
Unfortunately, what we see is a lot of our young people kind of stereotype the police. Now, it's an opportunity for us today to show the many facets of police work.
The tour was also a chance for officers to look at some potential recruits. The Aboriginal population is underrepresented in the New South Wales Police Service, with only 76 officers on the streets from a total of 13,000, and another 56 in liaison positions.
Hopefully out of today, we might have one or two of these young people show an interest in coming along and joining us in the service. At the moment, we simply don't have enough Aboriginal people with us in the service.
Some of our students might become a policeman or a police lady, and it'll be very lovely to see some of our black face, Aboriginal faces in the police force.
Clearly they have their budgetary needs and their reasons, but they need to be aware of the Newcastle community's opinion and desires, and that's what we'll be acquainting them with.
Many would remember America's World Cup win last year. It was a little hard to forget given the celebrations. Now the toast of women's soccer, the flamboyant Americans will play Australia in the final match of the Pacific Cup tournament. Scotland and Brazil have withdrawn from the championship, and a revised draw secured Newcastle as the venue of the much-anticipated clash on June 11. In local soccer this weekend, it's round 11 of the NBN League with Toronto taking on Maitland, while on Sunday, Adamstown play Highfields, Hamilton is at home to Wall's End, while Broadmeadow head to Belmont, and two games are at the Coalfields. Round 5 in Newcastle Rugby League has Cessnock taking on Maitland tomorrow, while Sunday, Lakes, the Blues, Central and South Newcastle are all at home. And in Newcastle Rugby Union tomorrow, Hamilton hosts the Students, Wanderers do likewise for the Bay, Singleton play Eastern Districts and Merriweather take on the Waratahs.
There's a sense of pride, lots of confidence in producing an outstanding training aircraft for the RAF.
Knights fans are still protesting over the loss of a favourite son, which the club blames on the National Rugby League salary cap.
We want Marty to stay, and if he doesn't stay, we won't stay.
The NRL wants the salary cap to contain player payments. Long-serving players like Matthew Johns received no special treatment, and he wasn't offered a contract for next year because it won't fit under the Knights' $3.25 million cap. Just this week, the NRL CEO, David Moffat, said it was almost impossible to do anything to change the rules before the next board meeting of the National Rugby League late this month. Too late for Matthew Johns. But the chairman of the Australian Rugby League says the situation should change.
I've spoken to David Moffat to request that he brings forward the next NRL board meeting so that the NRL board can consider the issue of changing the rules of the salary cap.
Open negotiations on players' contracts begin in June, and Mr. Hill now believes the possibility of a special provision for long-serving players is more realistic.
If we can get the rules of the NRL changed, that allows us to reconsider our position with Matthew.
It may have been early morning, but there was no way anyone was sleeping with 41 cars warming up their engines. In all, 180 motoring enthusiasts were preparing to head out on a 3,000-kilometre trek as part of the Newcastle Variety Club Bash.
Well, it's a fair old trek. Without naming every town we go to, we'll be going in through Oberon, to Queanbeyan, out to Echuca, then back through West Wyalong up to Narromine, and then up to the Jazz Festival at Morpeth next week.
Hours of hard work from the volunteers have gone into decorating the cars.
They really are dedicated to this charity. They really are dedicated to this event, and they put a lot of time and effort into it.
And with the marching band leading the way, they were off. And they came in all makes and models with every siren imaginable. But aside from all the fun and games, there is a serious side to the event. Organisers are hoping to raise at least $150,000 for disadvantaged and disabled children. The bash will finish up at the Morpeth Jazz Festival next Saturday. Tanya Carlisle, NBN News.
Tasman Hogben wandered away from his Cohyba home late yesterday. The 84-year-old is in the late stages of Alzheimer's disease, adding to police concerns for his welfare.
Since being notified, we've searched all the local areas and all the shopping centres with no result.
This morning, the Westpac helicopter searched from the air, and with still no luck, police started a ground search from the Burwood Street house. SES personnel scoured nearby bushland, climbing through dense undergrowth on hands and knees.
We've also done a door knock and covered all of the local houses and streets to see if Mr. Hogben has been seen.
Police will search local streets by car this evening before launching a major search tomorrow morning if there's still no sign. Mr. Hogben is of average height and of medium build. He was last seen wearing glasses, a navy blue baseball cap, grey trousers and cardigan. Brooke Webster, NBN News.
For a race with so much on the line, Justin Norris looked remarkably calm before the start. But once in the water, it was all or nothing. Alongside Australian champion Matthew Dunn, Norris set the early pace. On his favourite stroke, the 19-year-old powered into the lead after the first leg. But he was quickly brought back to the field, and at one stage he'd faded to fourth. With only the top two qualifying for Sydney 2000, he wasn't given much of a chance midway through. And when they turned into the final 100 metres, it was a four-man race and on to Dunn's favourite stroke freestyle. With Justin's parents, Gary and Jenny, cheering from poolside, incredibly he fought his way back on the last turn to lead. And the final stretch was a neck-and-neck battle between the master and his apprentice. By just 0.27 seconds, bid in a time 6 seconds better than his previous personal best and more than enough to have him in the Olympic team. On a night where Thorpe and Hugel starred, Norris was still a notable favourite. He swims again tonight along with Tarrant Callaghan and Yvette Rodier. From taking on the Bulldogs to tackling the beach, the Knights camp is happy once again. Saturday night's win, only Newcastle's second away from Marathon Stadium this year.
Oh, it was. And the circumstances under which it was procured were really good.
Injury ripped apart the side in the lead-up, but nothing was more devastating than the news on the eve of the game for young winger Justin Ryder. After hearing of his grandfather's death, Ryder couldn't have played better, scoring 2 tries in a game he dedicated to his pop.
I'd say thank you because he's been a big part of my life and he's probably been one of my biggest supporters, and I guess it was just to say thank you for all his support over the years.
Some encouraging signs also today with Robbie O'Davis and Matthew Gidley both running well today. And while Matt Parsons was iced up, he expects to be back this weekend. Jim Callanan, NBN News.
It's not the first time Stockton Dunes, just north of Newcastle, has been used as a movie or TV backdrop. One of the Mad Max movies was shot here, but this time round it's the Miss Hong Kong Beauty Pageant. Organisers have flown in 20 girls, plus a big production crew from Hong Kong's TVB, to shoot the contestants in a variety of different action roles, including riding quad bikes, windsurfing and rock climbing.
And we find this place is, you know, just gorgeous. You know, we have the beach on the one side, but then we have a desert on the other side. You know, it's so hard.
The reason the production crew chose Australia is because of its image as a summer wonderland full of sun, sea, sand and surf. Well, they got here and found most of those ingredients, all except the summer.
But once the director shouted action, off came the parkas and on came the music.
We have to grab the attention of the viewers, so we decided to put some outdoor shootings, like we picked this place, and we train our ladies here, you know, to show the audience that, you know, they're not just, you know, beauty on the face of it, but then they could, you know, do some action stuff.
So the Hong Kong women are versatile?
Yes, 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 definitely.
The exposure for Newcastle and The Hunter is virtually priceless. Millions of viewers, not only in Hong Kong, but parts of southern China will be watching.
If you look at it in terms of media exposure, we're talking millions of dollars, quite literally millions of dollars to buy that kind of exposure in those markets.
Matt Carden, NBN News.
The manager of the Wallaroo Colliery Coal Operations Australia say low coal prices and subsequent losses recently of almost $4 million have forced them to search for ways to keep the mine operating. But if a viable option can't be found, 87 jobs will have to go on the 23rd of next month. The company met with the union representing the workers on Monday, and despite plans for further talks, the union says there are no other options open.
Costs can't be cut. If costs can't be cut and prices can't be improved, what else is there?
And Mr Murray says alternative job prospects for the workers aren't good. There are calls for federal government involvement in price negotiations and planning for the industry.
And not only has the federal government got a role to play, but the state governments have got a role to play. That again, we're faced with another coal mine that'll be closed, that's still got plenty of reserves.
The colliery's future will be discussed again on Friday. Brooke Webster, NBN News.
There was good reason for pleasantries. Four more companies receiving financial assistance from the $10 million Hunter Advantage Fund have added 76 jobs to the overall tally. Mr Carr also launched the Hunter Advantage strategy, promising 5,000 extra jobs by 2002, and welcomed the chief as the region's official ambassador. Paul Harrigan implored all the business and government figures present to make sure Newcastle delivered on its potential.
Cities don't get the opportunity like we have to start from scratch, like with honeysuckle right in our most important part of the city on the wharf, and to do it right. And there's different parts of town that's got to need improving, and the time's right now.
Next stop, the RTA call centre, delivered as part of the government's policy of shifting services from Sydney, with 165 jobs for Newcastle.
37 were already here, 28 are coming in from other parts of the RTA, but 100 permanent jobs for people in the Hunter region.
And the Premier quashed assertions by his Hunter-based members that the corporatisation of Pacific Power was merely the son of privatisation, which would cost 300 jobs.
They are simply wrong, and they shouldn't be saying that, because it's not right.
According to New South Wales Premier Bob Carr, the Hunter will feature strongly in next Tuesday's budget. During a visit to the area yesterday, he said almost one third of the $20 billion to be spent over 4 years will go to Labor heartland, and health will benefit.
Well, I've been Premier. Health spending's gone up by something close to 40%.
That message was repeated by Health Minister Craig Knowles today, but while he refused to spell out the allocated funding, he says projects like the upgrading of the Mater Hospital may just get a start.
I want to preempt to some degree by saying I want to start the process of getting on with the future of health services in the Hunter.
One of those services includes the launch of an Australian first in Newcastle today. GPs now going online with the treatment of illnesses such as heart conditions with the aid of a computer.
What it does release them from is that systematic stuff, the stuff of not forgetting the things that absolutely need to be done every time, so they can concentrate on the real patient, the complex patient that's sitting in front of them, the human being that's sitting in front of them, and they can focus on that.
Health absorbs money like a sponge, but this is one way of making sure that every dollar that we do spend is being used in the wisest possible fashion.
Helen Kapalos, NBN News.
As the Knights struggle to hold on to rugby league's best combination, the offers from opposing clubs keep rolling in, and they're attractive. Two English clubs who haven't been named have offered the siblings $700,000 each per season to play together. Two NRL clubs have also expressed interest in signing both players. Their manager John Fordham this afternoon confirmed the approaches, but says neither player is in a hurry to make a decision. Meanwhile, the Knights are acclimatising for their trip to the warmer climes of Townsville, training in tracksuits to prepare for Sunday's clash with the Cowboys. The trip north has been a hoodoo in the past, the Knights winless on each occasion.
It's very important we play well up there. It's going to be a very tough game in the heat.
Once again, there'll be some fresh faces in the Knights' lineup. David Fairley says the likes of Ryder, Abraham and Holbrook have more than accounted for themselves.
They're playing really well, and the guys in the side that have been there a while are, you know, really proud of, you know, how they're going about their job.
Blake Doyle, NBN News.
Realistically, Norris had little hope of Olympic qualification in the 200 metres butterfly. Australian record holder Scott Goodman already has an Olympic bronze, and Scott Miller owns the country's third best time. What's worse, the Newcastle Flyer was second last off the blocks. After the first turn, Goodman and Miller began to fight it out for the lead. But by the 150 metre mark, the field began to reel in the old guard. The Stockton teenager continued his charge right to the wall. Qualifying for his second Olympic event with his best time by over 1.5 seconds, Norris was gracious in defeat.
On the 100th at the end, it couldn't have been any closer really, but Heath, great swim by him.